subscribe to Bizbo and press the bell icon. See boring news turn into enjoyable stories. Since 1960, over 300 people have lost their lives trying to summit Everest. Most lie where they fall, as it's too difficult and costly to bring a body down. Some become famous landmarks like Green Boots from 1996, who took a break before summiting but never got up. More than 100 have never been found, though some reveal themselves every now and then.
Snow is melting because of global warming and long-lost bodies are surfacing.
Mountaineering is inherently unsafe, and this was highlighted when even some world-class professional climbers died back in 2019. Scotland-based Brit Martin Moran or Nanda Devi, Bulgarian mountaineer Ivan Tomov climbing the Lhotse Peak or South Summit, Chilean climber Rodrigo Vivanco, Kanchenjunga, and Peruvian Richard Hidalgo on Makalu considered the most technically difficult. Just over 5,000 climbers, not counting an equal number of Sherpas, have conquered Everest's 8,850-meter, 29,035 feet peak. Since it was first summited in 1953 by New Zealander Sir Edmund Hillary and Sherpa Tenzing Norgay. Not many know, however, that a year earlier, Tenzing and the Swiss alpinist Raymond Lambert made it to 8,600 meters before.
The weather on Chomolungma is very bad. We should not proceed. But the summit is just 900 feet away.
While there were only a few climbers in those days, the 2019 season saw a huge traffic jam waiting to summit the mountain. John Krakauer, in his book Into Thin Air, writes how the mountain has now got heavily commercialized.
Safety methods are sometimes ignored to get the maximum number to the summit,
resulting in climbers with only limited experience attempting to reach the peak. Arguably, Dick Bass, a wealthy American, in 1985 started the trend of amateur climbers by paying big bucks to Sherpas to help him accomplish the feat. Really speaking, only those with the experience of climbing at least 7,000 meters, approximately 21,000 feet, should try to scale Mount Everest.
I underwent training for 2 years, climbed a few peaks in India and Nepal before attempting to summit Everest. It was my previous trekking experience and the rigorous preparation I had put myself through that helped me reach the summit.
The Himalayan Mountaineering Institute was established in Darjeeling in November 1954 for just this purpose. After India's then Prime Minister Pandit Nehru facilitated Sherpa Tenzing Norgay.
We should encourage and train others too in the technique of mountaineering.
HMI, run by the Indian Army, charges ridiculously low rates of ₹16,940 for Indians and $880 for foreigners, for 28 days, including accommodation and all meals. Though climbing Everest remains a formidable physical and mental challenge, lighter, warmer clothing and newer equipment makes it progressively safer, but encourages amateur climbers. Brit Nick Hollis, one of only 500 to have conquered the highest peak in all 7 continents or the 7 summits, cautions.
Too many inexperienced climbers create bottlenecks in the technical sections of the route,
endangering theirs and others' lives. An elevation above 8,000 meters, approximately 25,000 feet, is called the dead zone, where atmospheric pressure is 1/3 of sea level and consequently, so is the oxygen you can inhale. Because clear summit days in the April early June season are limited to just a few weeks, everyone shows up at around the same time. This window is often squeezed further due to cyclonic weather, bunching climbers into shorter 3-4 day windows, making the extra wait up there during traffic jam days fatal for those who run out of bottled oxygen. At temperatures of minus 60 degrees Celsius, when you're almost stationary for extended periods of time, your brain can begin to swell due to hypoxia, lack of oxygen, and your stomach stops digesting food, starving you of energy, while your heart stops pumping blood to your extremities, like fingertips, toes, and nose, leading to discoloration and severe, sometimes irreversible frostbite. But even at this height, some precariously perched climbers were seen shoving and pushing their neighbors. For what else? The perfect selfie. Another reason for traffic jams is because access to the summit is extremely narrow and can be reached only by a single one-way rope used both for going up and coming down. Till 2015, the Hillary Step, a 40-foot truck-sized boulder-like step at 8,790 meters, had always been the biggest bottleneck for climbers and appeared as a backdrop in many pictures. But it was likely shaken loose during the 7.9 magnitude earthquake that hit Nepal in April 2015. With the Hillary step gone, climbers now simply walk up a 30-degree snow slope to reach the summit. And when you do reach the flat part of the summit, which is about the size of two ping pong tables, it's not that you have time to enjoy it in solitude or the opportunity to soak in the view from the highest point on the planet. It's standing room only, packed with 15 to 20 people at a time.
Sir, we need to get back down. Other people are waiting.
Lhotse, the South Summit and Balcony are other popular peaks climbed by mountaineers. The location of Everest is such that the exact same summit can be reached from the Tibet side too, which has an easier initial climb but gets progressively more difficult and technical. China grants just 300 permits per season and consequently there are no lines on the Tibet side. Other famous mountains, of course not as high, attract a far greater number of mountaineers. Denali in Alaska attracts over 1,000 climbers each year. Europe's tallest mountain, Mont Blanc, 25,000. While Africa's tallest, Kilimanjaro, gets a massive 50,000 mountaineers each year. Even in the midst of Corona and cyclones Tauktae and Vyas this year, Nepal still issued 408 permits, though China has completely closed the Tibet side of the mountain this season. This is because mountain tourism earns more than $300 million for the country, forming the backbone of Nepal's economy. Local tour operators will even provide Wi-Fi and unlimited internet high up on the mountains, heated dining tents and movie nights too, but at a cost between $40,000 to $130,000 per person. But Sherpas, who do all the heavy lifting, like charting routes, tying knots and ropes, carrying luggage, and even cooking, are barely able to make ends meet once the season is over. Tenzing's son, Dame Norgay, tells us a darker side of the profession.
Sherpas do this to continue their tradition, but are being fooled into a false sense of pride.
An example of this noble though false pride was when Sherpa Dawe Sange's client collapsed at base 4 at 8,600 meters after returning from summiting the peak in 2017. Then in a selfless act of sacrificing his own oxygen in the hope that his client would live, he closed his eyes and drifted into unconsciousness. Early the next morning, another group of returning Sherpas and Shering, Nima Gyalzen and others discovered him lying in the tent, unconscious but alive, and made a daring rescue, carrying him down the precarious slopes back to safety. For some climbers, Everest is there to be conquered in a battle against the elements. For some, it is a trophy achievement they can boast about. But for others, it's a sense of hope. 2021 saw 46-year-old Chinese Zhang Hong becoming just the third blind person to scale Everest. And when in 2019, six Arab women from Saudi Arabia, Oman, Lebanon and the Emirates summited Everest, they made history by breaking centuries of male dominance. It is this attraction to breaking barriers, both societal and personal, that scaling Everest means. Bisbo's limerick. Summiting Everest is no easy task. Both mentally and physically, it's still a big ask. A once recluse peak has shed its mystique. Even for amateur climbers, it's now within their grasp. Subscribe to Bisbo and click on the bell icon to get notified whenever Bisbo releases a new video. Sources of all our information is listed in the video description section.